This video is brought to you by Audible. Go to audibletrial.com/halocanon for a 30-day free trial and a free credit on an audiobook download. Stay tuned for more details. When Halo: The Fall of Reach released in 2001, it was aimed at a 17-plus crowd, the same demographic that the upcoming Halo CE would target. This continued to be the case for the next 18 years until the start of 2019, when Halo: Battleborn released. Battleborn, written by Cassandra Rose Clark and published by Scholastic Books, is the first in a series of young adult-focused Halo novels, a shift from what we typically expect from our favorite franchise. Now, one could argue that 2017's Halo Legacy of Onyx could be considered the first YA novel, and while it certainly has elements common to YA, it's not how it was billed. That honor goes to Battleborn. When first announced, people had some adverse reactions, from a mild eye roll to declaring they'd never pick up the book at all, which is a genuine shame because, you guessed it, it's a pretty good book. The focus on teens can be a bit of a turnoff at face value, but this isn't something that Halo hasn't done well before, such as with Sadie's Story from Halo 3 ODST or the ARG I Love Bees, both projects that Battleborn evokes throughout its pages. But enough defending, let's let the book speak for itself. Sort of. Spoilers ahead, but as usual, I have a spoiler-free wrap-up at the end. Skip to the time shown on screen or listed in the description box if you want to avoid spoilers. For everyone else, this is Halo: Battleborn. Our story opens in the house of Evie Russo as she asks her father if she can go out with a friend, Victor Gallardo, to a concert. Very typical teen stuff right off the bat, but it's there to establish Evie's home life. Evie's father, a professor at the nearby Meridian University, values his daughter's education, that she is challenged, but also just wants her to be happy. So, with her father's approval, Evie departs to meet up with Victor, whom she finds filling a Sardon's cat, a species of wild cat on Meridian not known for coming deep into human territories. Now, we as readers know going in that Meridian is a planet that will be attacked in 2548, and the three-year-long siege ends with the planet's glassing, among other details. This moment and others like it in the opening chapters hint to new fans that something is amiss, and to the more knowledgeable that we're on the eve of a Covenant invasion. Brilliant foreshadowing by the author, I have to say. Moving on, the two teens head to their concert, and as they do, we get a little insight into the history of Meridian. The concert is being held in an abandoned luxury vacation home, one of many near the village of Broome-sur-Mer, where Evie lives. Prior to the war, it was common for the rich of the galaxy to visit Meridian. Tourism, though, has all but died with the outbreak of the Covenant War. The teens start speculating on what could have driven the Sardon's cat towards the village, Victor thinking the UNSC are doing something out there. Evie, meanwhile, is skeptical of that. We learn during this section that Evie's mother joined the UNSC Marine Corps about 5 years ago, as did Victor's older sisters, Maria and Camila. While visiting, Victor's sisters would often show both Evie and Victor how to shoot. As the pair arrives at the concert, Victor starts filming, being something of a futuristic YouTuber. Once inside the venue, we're introduced to our two other main characters, Dorian Nguyen, one of the members of the band playing, and Saskia Nazari, a fashionable girl whose parents had moved to Meridian about 5 years ago. Just as the concert starts, the power to the entire town goes out. The town's AI, Salome, a superintendent-like character, announces that the power should be up soon. And it is, and the band continues like nothing happened. Boy, just for a first chapter, there's a lot going on there. First, the world is really well fleshed out, featuring details that make it feel alive. Second, the foreshadowing of the Covenant. And finally, just civilian life being highlighted. And regarding that last point, it's noted that some members of the band and the attendees themselves have done up their makeup to make themselves resemble members of the Covenant, showing just how disconnected Meridian and by extension parts of human space can be from this war. And I imagine this is especially true of younger generations. Overall, great start. Moving on, the second chapter focuses on Dorian, and note each chapter shifts perspective. But anyway, we find Dorian the next morning tired from his long night as he joins his Uncle Max on a job to the town's fusion reactor. Not long after arriving, Dorian finds what caused the outage, a scorch mark along the reactor, likely what you'd see from a Covenant plasma strike. The two watch security footage from the night before, but all they see is a blinding light at the time of the blackout, and then nothing. With the reactor currently working, the pair can't do much else but move on to their next job, fixing a leaking roof and some signal lights. On the way to the next job, they check on Max's son, Dorian's nephew Remy, and later, Dorian receives a text from a bandmate that they have another gig that night, much to Dorian's excitement. They soon arrive at a Mr. Garzon's place. While Max takes a look at the leak, Dorian takes a Scud Rider, a one-man aerial vehicle, out to the signal lights, which are used to guide ships to shore. To his horror, he finds damage similar to that of the reactor. Interior wiring and circuit boards fried black. We then shift perspectives to Victor, who is preparing to film a scene from a movie he's making. So on top of basically being the future version of a YouTuber, he's also something of a filmmaker. He calls up Evie and they meet near the sea to shoot a scene where a monster attacks an old Earth city. Victor created a scale model of the city complete with mini lights to destroy and a metal monster to destroy it. Evie had programmed the monster. This and other context clues hint at Evie's ability and intelligence, something important later in the story. Suddenly during filming, a loud crack thunders through the area. Victor tries to play it off as lightning, hoping it's lightning, but Evie isn't so sure. Meanwhile, Dorian and his band, Drowning Chromium, are on a boat owned by one Tomas Reynes, playing a set for a crowd. Needless to say, this is a big deal for their band. Unfortunately, as I'm sure you've guessed, the Covenant interrupts. Ships pass overhead, plasma rains down, and a pod of drones drops directly onto the boat. As they open fire, Dorian attacks one to distract them as his friends escape, before diving into the ocean to escape himself. Victor and Evie, in the meantime, had packed up and were headed back into town as soon as they saw the Covenant. As Evie keeps trying to contact her father, the town network being down, the two find themselves confronted by a fortunately weaponless Jackal. This doesn't make things too much easier, however. The Jackal is able to grab Evie and almost kills her, possibly planning to eat her, when Saskia Nazari shows up with a rifle and kills it. She invites Evie and Victor back to her place, which has its own power supply. Victor wants to head into town to the shelter, but Saskia reveals that the town is under control by the Covenant. Once again, I need to stop and praise the author here. The visceral feeling of dread as the Covenant suddenly show up on Meridian is palpable through the perspective of these teens, and probably gives us our best look at a civilian reaction to the Covenant since Sadie's story in Halo 3 ODST. In fact, as I said earlier, I get a lot of Sadie's story's vibes throughout this book. Moving on, Saskia takes the two to her house, which is basically a fortress at this point. Saskia's parents work for Chalab's Defense Solutions, and thus have a lot of prototype and experimental technology, including a new state-of-the-art barricade system. Incidentally, Chalab should sound familiar from all those cannon fodder videos I did in the past, as they provided a number of weapon systems and Mjolnir to the UNSC, both during the war and after. Once inside, Saskia retrieves a health pack, a military one, to treat Evie's ankle, damaged from her encounter with the Jackal. After that, the teens head into Saskia's safe room where they use the comm equipment to try and contact anyone in Broom-sur-Mer. The first channel they try ends up accidentally crossing with a Covenant one, giving them a blast of Sangheili gibberish. They quickly try other channels only to find an emergency broadcast and nothing else. Distraught, Evie wants to head into town, but Victor and Saskia convince her to rest. They all rest, ready to figure out their next moves in the morning. On a beach, Dorian awakes the next morning, barely remembering anything after he jumped ship. After taking in his surroundings, he spots a comm tower, meaning he was close to town. He heads towards Broom-sur-Mer, positive the Covenant would have headed towards population centers like Port Moyne or Agen, hoping in Broom-sur-Mer he can find the UNSC and check on his uncle and nephew. Of course, he instead finds the Covenant in Broom-sur-Mer, almost coming face to face with them. Thinking things through, he figures that if the UNSC were going to set up anywhere nearby, it would be somewhere with its own power grid, which of course leads him to the rich neighborhood, which eventually leads to Saskia's house. He manages to get Saskia's attention and is let in, where he and the group of teens fill each other in on what's been going on. Saskia, Victor, and Evie start arguing about the potential state of the town, when Dorian suggests just asking Salome. While the town network is down, a town computer would let them communicate with her directly. Victor is nervous, but Evie is resolute, determined to contact her dad. She hadn't told him she was going to help out Victor prior to the attack, so he'd have no idea where she was or if she was alive. Saskia brings up the possibility of patrols, to which Dorian responds they'll simply have to fight. They may only have one rifle according to Saskia, but it's a gun nonetheless. After lunch, the group heads out, Dorian taking point with the rifle and leading them deep into the woods nearby, heading towards town. Heavy rain masks the sounds as they move. Victor's sister Maria had always told him that if the Covenant were to invade, he'd better hope it was during the rainy season. Rain would not only cover their noise, but they'd be more used to it and the terrain than the Covenant. Speaking of, they soon encounter some Covenant off in the distance, human weapons fire accompanying the Covenant plasma. They catch a brief glimpse of a grunt being gunned down, and then it's over. Victor picks up a Needler from the fallen Ungoy, and Saskia a plasma rifle. The group then moves on. They finally come across the computer and contact Salome. From her, they learn that 70% of the town made it into the shelter, including Dorian's Uncle Max and nephew Remy, Evie's father, and Victor's parents. Saskia's parents had been out of town. With that confirmed, the group tries to figure out how they can evacuate the people. The shelter is well secured, but not well stocked. The time the people can survive in there is limited. The group argues about it for a while, but they figure that they can get to one of the more secluded shelter entrances and evacuate people through there. Evie figures she can get into Salome's program and convince her to open just the one door. It's not much of a plan, but it's something, and everyone agrees it needs to be done. While Saskia and Victor head into town, Dorian and Evie access Salome once again. They try reasoning with her, but Salome won't budge. So, Dorian hands over his work compat, allowing Evie access into Salome's code. Problem is, once in, she finds it to be a jumbled mess from all the additions and modifications made over the years to the overly complicated base code that made up her core. Evie had been messing with AI code and talking about how to make a true artificial intelligence without the need for a brain scan for years with her father, but her theoretical experience isn't enough to mess with Salome. Defeated, Evie closes the code, instead modifying the emergency message to get Saskia and Victor to return to them. In Broom-sur-Mer, Saskia and Victor are on their way to the shelter unaware of Evie's message. Unfortunately, the two run into a hunter. They only barely escape a few blasts from its fuel rod cannon, and when finally cornered, they are saved by a Spartan in dark blue armor, the Spartan 3 we will come to know as Owen B096. Owen creates an opening for the kids to escape, catching up to them once the hunter is dealt with. He asks why kids are out in the town and if they have any place to go. Saskia says it's a long story, and Victor notes that Saskia's house is safe. Owen acknowledges, and they move out. The trio soon meet up with Dorian and Evie, they're introduced to Owen, and they all head back to the house. While Dorian, Victor, and Evie rush inside, Saskia, having noticed Owen had been injured, offers to use the health pack to patch him up. Owen accepts, but only out of sight from the other teens, for morale purposes, as he explains. And now we come to a moment that is, to say the least, a little odd. Owen removes the damaged armor over his wound, then Saskia somehow manages to cut the undersuit and then apply some biofoam. So yeah, we need to talk about this. Somehow, scissors are able to cut through Mjolnir's undersuit. And make no mistake, Owen almost certainly has Mjolnir if the cover is anything to go on. Never mind that, this being the year 2548, he would have been one of the Spartans of Beta Company pulled for special teams. Said special teams have always been clad in Mjolnir, such as the case of Kevin A282, who also fought on Meridian during his career. And before anyone suggests it, it's unlikely Owen is a headhunter, as he notes that he came with a team. Two Spartans does not a team make. Back on topic though, there's no way scissors could even attempt to cut through Mjolnir or even spy's undersuit if you want to believe that it's spy armor. In reality, I think this was an oversight by the author in 343, but this is a lore channel, so I'd like to propose a way that this could work. Examining the text, what Saskia cuts into is a, quote, black bodysuit. We know by the time of the Spartan 4 program, Spartans wear what can be called a skin suit, under the tech or undersuit. Perhaps this, or its predecessor, is what Saskia cut into. Perhaps Owen not only removed the armor plating, but a section of the undersuit as well. There's nothing in the lore that expressly says this can't be done, and we've seen depictions of Mjolnir's undersuit being assembled in pieces, much like the armor plating itself. Although, all this said, I'm still curious why they couldn't just use Mjolnir's built-in biofoam ports, which existed on Mark IV. Anyway, once everyone is cleaned up, Owen talks about their next step, which is to get the kids out of Broom-sur-Mer and meet up with UNSC forces. The teens are reluctant, not wanting to leave their families, but Owen insists and promises to return for them. As they reach the edge of town, they run into an energy barrier, a dome surrounding the entire town. They also encounter some Covenant and only barely make it back to Saskia's house and into the safe room. Once inside, Owen opens up a little, revealing that the attack on Meridian actually began a week before, with Meridian's Air Force having held off the Covenant for several days before it broke through. This was possible in part because the fleet the Covenant brought wasn't a full-sized one. Locked into their town with no idea of what the Covenant want, it's Evie who suggests that Owen train them and that they spy on the Covenant. Everyone's reluctant at first, but they soon realize it's all they can do. Interestingly, we'd learned during this section that schools not only teach about the Covenant, but actually teach the species name for each Covenant species, rather than the UNSC designations. Whether it's just something on Meridian or not is unclear, but it's an odd choice to say the least. On an unrelated note though, I love that the domed energy shield technology from Halo Wars appears here, and I love the reference to the Meridian Air Force. In the lore, it's noted that the Meridian Air Force is the reason that fighting on Meridian lasted 3 years. Moving on, Owen brings the teens to the Force just outside Saskia's home to train. Split again into groups of two, their job is to try and catch Owen by surprise. If they can't do it to a Spartan, they haven't a hope against the Covenant. It's a slow go as Owen constantly catches them, as you would expect from a Spartan, but eventually Dorian and Evie figure to go up into the trees. They manage to create a diversion and get the literal drop on Owen. The next night, Dorian and Evie head into town. As they survey the damage and abundance of Covenant comm towers, a locust suddenly appears, trudging into the old parts of town. To their surprise, it starts digging. Meanwhile, Victor and Saskia are exploring the woods around Broome-sur-Mer, when they suddenly find themselves in a large clearing, and in that clearing is a hangar. Quite conveniently, the hangar's lock was made by CDS, the company that Saskia's father works for, and in the past 50 years, the override code that she happened to know hasn't changed a bit. Inside, the pair find a long-abandoned prowler with the mark of the Sundered Legion, an old insurrectionist group that had once operated out of Meridian. Even luckier, they find military-grade communications equipment. Although the Covenant is jamming all broadcasts in the town, a brief bit of conversation makes it through as Saskia and Victor are trying to work the radio, revealing that the Covenant are searching for an artifact. Now, I don't want to rag on this too much, as in context it kind of flows pretty well, but damn, what a series of lucky events. A hangar with a prowler and a working radio? Talk about a jackpot. Never mind that they show up just in time to hear some key plot-relevant stuff. Thankfully, this is the only time this sort of thing happens, but it was a little jarring how convenient it all was. Anyway, everyone soon meets up back at Saskia's house, reporting what they found. Upon learning of the artifact and the locust, Owen reveals that the artifact is likely Forerunner, and that the Covenant is after it because they worship the Forerunners. Further, he eventually reveals that the Forerunners are connected to why the Covenant want to wipe out humanity. It's a little odd for a Spartan to be spouting off what he basically confirms is classified intel, but I suppose it could be forgiven, given that the teens probably need to know about this. What I find more interesting, though, alongside with teaching about the Covenant in schools, is that apparently schools teach that the Covenant worship the Forerunners. It caught me off guard, but Halo Wars Genesis, the prequel comic that came with the limited edition of the original Halo Wars, depicted Professor Alan Anders teaching theoretical xenoarchaeology, so I guess it's not too much of a stretch. But with this new information, Owen suggests a change in tactics. The next night, under cover of rain, the group enacts a plan to take out the Locust. Owen had told them that its defenses were weak. Saskia is put up in a coffee shop, where she would provide backup. When the Locust appears and she doesn't hear from her team, Saskia opens fire on it. She manages to hit the Locust in a weak spot, disabling it, and then runs for the nearby forest. She manages to lose any Covenant pursuers, then heads for their rendezvous point. Unfortunately, when she arrives, no one else is there. So, she heads back out to find her team. It isn't too long before she finds them still setting up explosives near the dig site. She warns them of the Covenant coming and they pull out, but not before setting off some of their explosives, which were construction-grade acquired from Dorian's house. Once detonated, they return to Saskia's to celebrate their victory. And as they celebrate, Owen notes that no reinforcements have been sent in, at least as far as he can tell. To him, this would mean that any potential reinforcements are being held up by Meridian's Air Force. Once again, a nice little reference to what little established lore we have. Owen also notes that they need to figure out why their private comm channel, which had worked at the house, hadn't worked in the field. Using the radio system in Saskia's safe room, Dorian and Evie contact Salome and discover that the Covenant jammers are proximity-based. Salome also tells them that the rain is increasing the risk of the shelter's flooding. The pair beg the AI to release the townfolk, but she insists that the Covenant threat is far greater than that of flooding. And that's when it clicks for Evie. She doesn't need to reprogram Salome, just trick her into thinking the Covenant are a lesser threat. And she can do that with a computer virus. And so, a plan begins to form. The group heads into the Sundered Legion hangar to see if the Prowler out there still works, and to everyone's surprise, especially Dorian's, the ship not only works, but its DNA-activated systems actually recognize Dorian as one Quinn Butane. Dorian notes that his grandmother's last name was Butane, but he knows of no Quinn. It's quickly brushed aside though, as all that matters is the ship works. Owen briefly tries to enter the cockpit, but the ship almost self-destructs. Owen notes that some security system likely detected his armor's energy signature, so anyone else on board should be fine. Now this is a little odd to say the least. What exactly is the ship detecting? The ship is said to have been abandoned for over 50 years, well before Mjolnir existed. Is it detecting his fusion power pack? Is it detecting some specific UNSC technology? Maybe we'll get a better explanation down the line, but right now I can't imagine what it could be. Anyway though, using the Prowler's stealth mode, Dorian and Saskia fly into town to scout out the shelter, where they find the Covenant are guarding or patrolling near it, and where they could evacuate the townsfolk from. After checking a few entrances, they find one that's virtually clear of any Covenant activity. Later, back at Saskia's place, while almost all of the group is gathered upstairs, Saskia is hiding away in the safe room, looking at a door that leads into another room, where her parents kept prototype weapons. We learned about this in an earlier chapter, but with the final assault looming, the weapons are needed now more than ever. But Saskia isn't sure how to tell her team. Owen shows up asking about the door, and when Saskia tells him, they talk about why she hadn't said anything. Saskia didn't grow up in Broome-sur-Mer or on Meridian at all. Her parents had moved there, and she'd been quite the outcast in her time. Small-town culture seems to remain just as strong as it does now. She didn't quite trust her team, and her parents' warning of secrecy had echoed through her mind whenever she thought about the door. But then we learn where Saskia's parents had gone, why they weren't in the town shelter. Their weapons developments weren't always for the UNSC, weren't always legal. And when the Covenant showed up, they jumped ship, running off and leaving their daughter, which, as we learn, isn't too common for them. Over the last week, Owen reminds Saskia, she had found a new family in Dorian, Victor, and Evie. She'd risked her life for them and worked with them. They were closer to her than her own parents had been. And so, with Owen's encouragement, Saskia finally tells her team, her friends, about the weapons. Naturally, they're all a little upset, but it soon passes, thanks especially to Evie's support. With the air now clear, Evie and Saskia go break into the weapons vault while Dorian, Victor, and Owen begin work on their strategy to evacuate Broome-sur-Mer. The girls head down to hack the lock, which Evie manages to do. She figures the lock is DNA-based like the Sundered Legion ship controls, and just expands the parameters until it recognizes Saskia. Once in, Evie calls everyone down and they examine what they have. Notably, there are prototypes for the railgun, the sticky detonator, and amalgamations of human and Covenant tech. As an example, they find a DMR which fires rounds coated in plasma. It's also noted later on that they found a weapon that surrounds bullets with an explosive orange energy, which sounds like some of the Halo 5 human-Promethean hybrid weapons. A bit early in the timeline for something like that, I would say. Arguably, one could say that Chalabs or Saskia's parents found some Promethean tech on Meridian and used it to make early prototypes of these hybrid weapons. It would give one reason why Saskia's parents might have moved to Meridian, although, again, it feels a bit weird to have this stuff this early in the timeline. Promethean tech certainly exists on Meridian given the Guardian beneath its surface, but a lot of that wasn't discovered until 10 years later. The next day, Evie finishes her virus, but while everyone celebrates, Owen reveals that the flooding in the town has worsened. So, the group rushes to put their plan into action. They would split into three groups. Dorian, Victor, and Owen would provide a distraction for the Covenant and try to destroy the generator for the energy dome. Evie would upload her virus into Salome's systems, and Saskia would head for the shelter entrance they'd unlock and lead the townspeople to the Prowler. Evie manages to find the town computer Dorian had told her about and upload her virus. As planned, Salome recognizes that the threat near shelter door number 5 has acceptably low threat levels and opens it. Meanwhile, on Broome-sur-Mer's beach, Owen, Dorian, and Victor plant what explosives they have left at the generator for the Covenant's domed energy shield. The explosives work and the shield falls. And of course that means the Covenant know exactly where they are. Further in town, Saskia waits for shelter door number 5 to open, and it soon does. She rushes in, soon finding the townspeople. They're panicked, Salome's announcement that the Covenant threat is, quote, at an acceptable level, confusing more than helpful. Accessing the shelter's comm systems, Saskia tells them that she and others have created a distraction and have a ship to evacuate the town. Eventually, she manages to empty the shelter and direct people towards the ship. Once in the woods, they encounter a Sangheili Ultra, though this one seemed to be wearing a non-standard armor as its arms are noted as being bare. But anyway, Saskia grabs its attention and leads it away from the group. She soon finds herself trapped in a tree, but this gives her an opening to unload a plasma rifle at the Sangheili, which almost melts the alien's arm off. She then uses this opportunity to drop out of the tree and run again. Meanwhile, Evie comes across Saskia and the townspeople and helps fight off a few more Covenant, including a Jackal sniper, before finding Victor's car and heading to the beach to collect everyone else. She soon arrives at the beach where Dorian, Victor, and Owen are pinned by an encroaching Covenant lance. Owen down and not moving, having recently been hit by plasma grenades. Evie uses the sticky detonator to break up the Covenant lines, allowing Dorian and Victor, with a lot of help from Owen, to load the Spartan into the car, followed by themselves, and then Evie gets them the hell out of there. When the group arrives at the hangar, they find the townspeople under attack from the Covenant. Evie and Victor quickly join those fighting back, while Dorian heads into the hangar. Powers up the Prowler, everyone files in, and they take off, stealth systems engaged. Once they break atmosphere, they find themselves under attack from a Covenant corvette, but manage to evade it just long enough. Activating their comm system and accessing a military channel, they broadcast a code given to them by Owen. The code is accepted, and the UNSC sends aid. As the survivors step off the Prowler and onto a UNSC cruiser, the Sparrow, Dorian, Victor, and Evie are able to reunite with their families. Saskia, of course, has no family, but finds herself embraced by Evie and her father, Dr. Mikhail Rousseau, who Saskia briefly ran into in the shelter during the evacuation. The group all head into the ship to get cleaned up and grab a hot meal. 2 days later, Victor, Dorian, Evie, and Saskia are called in by Oni. Along with Owen, they meet a woman named Daniela to have a discussion about their actions on Meridian, a full report having been submitted by the Spartan. The group are told that they're to receive the UNSC Medal of Honor, the highest award a civilian can receive, and they'll be the youngest to receive it. Second, they're offered an opportunity. They'd be inducted into a truncated version of Oni's Ground Operatives Training Program, and when complete, at which time they'll be 18, they'll be sent back to Meridian as part of a special team to recover whatever Forerunner artifact the Covenant were searching for. Dorian is the first to speak up, having been fairly anti-UNSC throughout, but Daniela points out that they technically wouldn't be part of the UNSC, but the Meridian Militia working with Oni. When no one else speaks up, Daniela steps out, leaving the 14s and Owen alone. Eventually, Saskia speaks up, volunteering, Evie follows soon after, then Victor, and finally Dorian. And that concludes Halo Battleborn, the first in a series of young adult-focused Halo novels. And damn, it was a pretty good read, I have to say. Something I will always appreciate is looking at the life of civilians across human space, and while we have several from various sources, the way the average UEG citizen reacts to an alien threat will always be at least somewhat varied. Thus, any new perspective is welcome, at least in my book. Battleborn absolutely capitalizes on this civilian perspective, giving us tastes of what life was like before the invasion and how that influences how the characters react to the Covenant. In addition to the civilian focus, Battleborn follows a group of teenagers being a young adult novel. This can be a tad risky for an established franchise, demonstrated by the initial reaction to this book, but damn did it pay off here. In fact, I'd go so far as to say the YA focus made the book better than it might have been otherwise. While one can criticize the YA genre for oversimplifications, which this book certainly does here and there, here I felt it further immersed you into the perspective of each character. The four main teens are very well written and relatable, and the few extra characters we encounter, notably Spartan Owen B096, are well characterized too. Best of all, the story does a great job of respecting established canon while not feeling restricted by it. This is aided, I'm sure, by the fact that the fall of Meridian isn't all that fleshed out. We know the basics, that the attack began in 2548, was held up for 3 years by the Meridian Air Force, until the final fall in 2551. There are small details that exist in there, but nothing all that concrete. This allowed for a new story to be told without too many restrictions, but with references to previously established lore. So overall, a damn good book, but not one without flaws. There are some canon oddities here and there, and there are some fairly convenient happenings that, while well written, will still make one turn one's head. With all that said, it's time to give a final score. With careful consideration, I give Halo Battleborn an 8 out of 10. A first great step into the YA scene, and I can't wait to see what comes next. And in point of fact, we have an idea of what comes next, as the title for Battleborn's sequel was announced. Titled Halo Meridian Divide, it's currently slated for release on October 1st this year. Don't look it up though if you don't want to spoil the ending to Battleborn, the book's description is pretty spoilery. Still, I love that title, and I may talk about what we can expect in the near future. But for now, I hope you enjoyed this review/summary. If you've read Halo Battleborn, what did you think of it? Let me know in the comments below. And as always, thank you for watching, and until next time, this has been Halo Canon. Thanks for watching. If you enjoy this, be sure to check out Audible. By going to audibletrial.com/halocanon, you can get a 30-day free trial and a free audiobook. Audible's selection is unmatched and includes all the Halo novels. You can cancel at any time and keep any audiobooks you've purchased. So check out audibletrial.com/halocanon today.